midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel, who dwell in the midst of Carmel. He, thy people, dwell the rod of flock of the heritage, who dwells olive tailed in the wood, in the midst of Carmel, who dwell 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 in the midst of Carmel.
Sins of time. Psalm 39 verse 1. I said, I will take heed to my ways. I said, I will take heed to my ways, that I sin not with my tongue. I sin not with my tongue. I will keep my mouth with a bridle while the wicked is before me. I will sin not with my tongue. There are many Bible verses about that tongue, and it is a very small organ, no bone in it, but this small organ, as a ship could be controlled with a small radar, or a small fire could destroy the whole forest, this small tongue can control the whole course of our life. The whole course of our life it can control. It can destroy our lives and the lives of other people. There is tremendous power in our tongue. Life and death are in the power of our tongue. Life and death are in the power of our tongue. So in Psalm 34 verse 13, keep thy tongue from evil. Tongue maintenance. Keep thy tongue from evil. So this morning I am confining my study only to the book of Psalms, maybe one or two references from other books, but the subtitles are only from the book of Psalms. How could we keep our tongue from evil? How is that we don't sin with our tongue? What are the sins we can make with our tongue? You and I have to be careful. How do we handle our tongue? Number one, Psalm 5 verse 9. I love that you could make a note of this. Taking notes is very, very useful. As an educator, I could tell you, when you listen to a message, only your auditory sense is at work. When you write down, your eyes, your ears, and your touch, you create, you write Psalms, you may put PS, you write, or you draw those letters with your fingers, and you write Psalm 5:9, and you see that. So without your knowledge, when you are taking down notes, three of your senses are in operation: your hearing, your touch, and your eyes. Psalm 5:9. For there is no faithfulness in their mouth. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their inward part is very wickedness. Their throat is an open sepulchre. They flatter with their tongue. One of the evils in our tongue, flattering, it is an evil. Flattering is not appreciating somebody. We should not make a mistake. Flattering is not appreciating somebody. It's not praising somebody for their good work. Flattering, speaking very high about somebody, only to get their gain, but when our heart doesn't agree with, concur with what we say. That much of praising, that much of appreciation is not in our heart. Oh, there's nobody like you. Oh, you are such a good man. I have never seen anybody like you. All those we say, but not because it is in our heart. We do flattering only to get their favor in one way or the other. So two points should be remembered in flattering. It's not appreciation, it's not praising. Number one, you are flattering somebody for your own gain. Number two, the words of appreciation that you pour out don't concur with your heart. That flattering is very, very dangerous. Job says, in Job 32, verses 21 and 22, it's very beautiful. Let me not, I pray you, accept any man's person, neither let me give flattering titles unto men. Flattering title, oh, ungala mari arume kediyathu. I will not do it, Job says. It is an integrity. I don't want anybody to flatter me. Please don't misunderstand. It's not appreciating. It's not praising somebody's good work. But flattering is slightly different from that. There is a nonsense different, but that difference is very important. He says, let me give neither let me give flattering titles unto men, for I know not to give flattering titles. Yesterday I prayed, Lord, give me that grace. I should not know how to give flattering titles. It's not only that I don't flatter, I need not know how to flatter. Already it is a problem with me, I don't know how to flatter people. I appreciate. I don't know to flatter. But yesterday I saw that in the Bible, Job says, I know not to give flattering titles. In so doing, my Maker would soon take me away. So Job says, if I do this flattering, my Maker will take me away. In Psalm 12 verse 2, they speak vanity, everyone with his neighbor, with flattering lips and with a double heart do they speak. So the flattering will have double heart. It's not a single heart. In verse 3, the Lord shall cut off all the flattering lips. So appreciating somebody unduly for our own gain, when that appreciation is not in our heart, it is a sin of the tongue. So the point that I'm going to share with you, it is for your own edification. Sometimes even when we do the introduction, introducing a speaker or somebody, You can share the facts of that person so that the audience can understand better. Something that really could appreciate his achievements. But what we're doing, flattering, only to get some favor of that speaker. God abhors it. You and I should be able to come out of that. But in the same time, please make sure it's not appreciation, it's not praising somebody's good work. So we have to be very careful to draw the lines, to make the nuances difference very clear. What is flattering and what is appreciation? The second one, you and I would have been a prey for this sin. But I love that we could be very careful about it. In Psalms chapter 52 verse 2, the tongue deviseth mischief. The tongue deviseth mischief like a sharp razor working deceitfully. The tongue deviseth mischief. Psalm 10 verse 7. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. Cursing, deceit, fraud, mischief, vanity. Five different words are used. But now we are going to consider the sin of mischief. There is mischief in our tongue. What is this mischief? Mischief. Very chief. What is mischief? So we all know what is mischief, but I want to understand from the dictionary what is mischief. It is a behavior, especially of a child. It is a behavior, especially of a child, that is slightly bad. It is a question whether it's a slightly bad or greatly bad. The Cambridge Dictionary says, slightly bad or caused trouble. Slightly bad or it causes trouble, but it's not intended to harm anyone. Mischief, the intention is not to harm anybody. It's a playful. It is playful. So what is meant in the Bible? What is meant in the Bible by this mischief? A rushing desire to harm. A rushing desire to harm. But not intentionally. The intention is not to cause harm, but it hurts, in a very playful word. So understand what does the Bible mean by mischief. The Tamil equivalent for mischief, in the translation they used kabadanavu, etc., etc. But literally, kurumbu. Nayandi, Geli. What the Bible meant, teasing somebody very quickly. Pullangu, Uru Vilavithal, hurting like. That mischief, it's like a sharp razor. It's a sharp razor. It is not a patakati. It is not a big sword. Nachin or vartha. Adi oosila, palathala oosi kuttara maari. கேலிக்கு பரியாசத்துக்கு நையாண்டி ஹர்ட்டிங் சம்படி. பட் லிசன், இஸ் இட் ராங், இஸ் இட் ராங்? ஆஸ் யூ க்ரோ மெச்சுவர்ட், மேபி எ சைல்ட்ஸ் பிளே, ஆஸ் யூ க்ரோ மெச்சுவர்ட், மெனி அ டைம் திஸ் ஸ்மால் ஸ்பார்க் ஹஸ் பேர்ன்ட் லைவ்ஸ். வி கோ பேக் அண்ட் சே, நான் சும்மா தான் சொன்னேன், கேலிக்கு தான் சொன்னேன், அவளை அளவைக்கணும்னு சொல்லலை. வி ஹவ் சோ மெனி திங்ஸ் டு சே, பட் த டேமேஜ் இஸ் வெரி ஹெவி. இட்ஸ் அ ஸ்மால் ஸ்பார்க் தட் கேன் பேர்ன் ஹோல் ஹவுஸ். எ ஸ்மால் ஸ்பார்க். So with a matchstick, we just play shooting rockets, just a play. It's a small play, but that can cause havoc. It's a small remark. The husband makes a remark on his wife, that would break her heart. 1,000 times he can say, I just said for joke, I just joked, but she cannot come out of it for her, for the rest of her life. That would have caused a very permanent damage. So we have to be very careful about this mischief also. Last night I sincerely prayed. I might have just said something for a joke. If that has hurt my wife permanently, Lord, forgive me. Forgive me. Why should my joke hurt somebody? Why should my mischief break somebody? In a jocular way I might have said. But that would have caused a permanent damage. Really, when I was preparing this, I prayed for me. Because I'm not saying all Nayandi is wrong. Generally, not to speak about me, but my age, my experience may permit me to speak about from my experience to help you. If I remember correctly, may God forgive me if I made a mistake. From my childhood, school days, college days, till this day, I cannot remember I have made a remark on somebody based on his color or his physical deformity. Ondra kannu, kucha kannu, kulla, gundu, karupen. Nonsense! Absolute nonsense! That's the mischief. That's the mischief. You know how much that would hurt that person? How much that would hurt that person? Even the marriage proposals, many a time I have preached this in this church. If you don't want somebody because they are very arrogant, you don't want somebody because they are very proud for some reason. But if you say somebody you don't want because they are black, it's not that person's fault. You are blaming God who created that person with dark skin. It is an accusation against God. If somebody, there is a deformity in their eyes and you make a comment on that, you are criticizing God who has created that person with that deformity. Chevudangava. And then undiya koopudu. Certainly they have to answer God. He has got a deformity of hearing, it is God's creation. So these type of things, the mischief, your intention is not to hurt, but that person is hurt. That person is hurt. He that is holy, let him be holy still. He that is holy, let him be holy still. My dear brother, my dear sister, somehow from my childhood, I don't remember till this day that I made a comment on somebody on their deformity or their complexion. That is mischief. You say a word about your wife. A hurting word. Then you can say, na velayattukkuthan sonna, velayattukkuthan sonna, adu vellado karuppado. But that's caused a permanent damage. A small fire, a small spark, that can cause havoc. So let us be careful about it. I don't want to make a big fuss about it. But the Bible speaks against mischief with your tongue. So it's better that we'll be careful about it. So first one, flattery. Flattery. Second one, playing mischief with our tongue. Maybe you are doing it in a playful way, but if that can cause a damage, it's better you don't do that, that's all. Number three, same verse 10, Psalm 10, verse 7, Psalm 10, verse 7. His mouth is full of cursing and deceit and fraud. Under his tongue is mischief and vanity. What is this vanity? Emptiness. Emptiness. Vain words. I mean, it's of not any use. It doesn't edify anybody. In Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, Matthew chapter 12, verse 36, but I say unto you that every idle word that men shall speak, they shall give account thereof in the day of judgment. Did Jesus mean it or not? How do you understand that? How can we give account of all the idle words we have spoken, vain words? In the Bible there are many references about vain words. I don't want to get into those vain words. I know a gentleman, for a long time he was practicing this. Before he would go to bed, he'll kneel down before God and he'll do an exercise. It's a very good exercise. It's a very good exercise to keep your memory cells active. From early morning till that time, he'll count all the words that he has spoken. What did I speak to my mom? What did I speak to my dad? What did I speak to my colleague? What did I speak over the phone? What did he ask me? What was the answer I gave? He will just travel along the memory lane. It's a very good exercise. From today you can start this. It is not only to have a perfect control over your tongue, but that helps you make your memory cells very active. Just before going to bed, in the presence of God, from the morning, what all you spoke? What all you spoke? To whom all you spoke? My dear brother, my dear sister, many a time people don't know how they should pray. It is another easier way to pray. Maybe once or twice or thrice a day. You go to a social network, your phone, get the registry, what all the phone calls you got, whom all you talk, what did you talk. Take an assessment in the presence of God. Keep your phone. Okay, morning 6 o'clock so and so phone me. This is what he said, this is what I said. Praise you Lord, give him good health, pray for him. Then 6:30 who phoned, or to whom you phoned? What are the calls you received, what are the calls you made? Maybe a midday prayer. Then go to your WhatsApp page. What are the messages you have seen, what are the messages you have forwarded, posted? Pray for them. Pray for them. It's a wonderful thing. I love to do that. I do it. I pray for the people whom I have posted. I pray for the people who have sent me some postings. If there's a prayer request, I remember that prayer request. And I pray. If I know there's a problem in that family, I pray for that family. And maybe 3 o'clock in the day, at the even falls, maybe at 3 or 6, second prayer, before going to bed, pray. Your life would become meaningful. Your postings would become meaningful. I don't say don't use WhatsApp. Use it powerfully. Use it for the glory of God. Use it as a tool for prayer. Use it as a ministry. That will be wonderful. We cannot be without these smartphones and other things today. Probably I think it is wrong or it is meaningless to say don't use phones, mobiles or smartphones. I tell you, use it for the glory of God. Use it as a tool for prayer. You get a very good prayer pattern. See, one prayer you can do at 10 o'clock, one prayer at 12 o'clock, one prayer at 3, one prayer before going to bed, or you can spread it through the day. Similarly, your phone registry, just a small prayer. And just recollect what you talked with that person. What did he say? What did you answer? My dear brother, my dear sister. Is there any vain words? I don't say you speak only 5 words or 10 words. I don't ration you are speaking. But let that chumma pesadinga. Chumma pesadinga. Paul says, be careful that nobody will destroy you with vain words. Veen vaarthigalale oruvar ungalai mosam pokkada padike echirikkar. Don't allow others also to talk with you with vain words. Veen vaarthai. The Bible says, veen vaarthinaale oruvar ungalai mosam pokkada padike echir. Be careful. There is a great servant of God, a saint by name J.F. Rowlands from South Africa. He used to say, my ears are not dustbins for anybody and everybody to put all the dust into my ears. My ears are not dustbins. So there are saints, those who are very careful about what they speak, they're very careful about what they hear. Your life would become more meaningful. I'm not talking about a monotonous, boring life. But I'm talking about a meaningful, a blessing life. A meaningful blessing. Speak to everybody. I'm not conservative. I'm by nature a cosmopolitan. I'm not conservative. My dear brother, my dear sister, but I don't want to talk vain words. I don't want to listen to vain words. Let there be some benefit to the hearer. Maybe a health tip. Maybe a motivational word. Maybe something that can edify. Something about the truth. Even in the humor, let there be a message, a moral, something that could benefit the hearer. We have to answer about every idle word that we speak. So we have to be very careful with our tongue. We don't use our tongue to speak idle words. Make a decision. He that is holy, let him be holy still. Let me go quick. Number 4. So flattering. And what's the second one? Mischief. And the third one, vanity. And the fourth one, chapter 12, verse 3. I'm confining with Psalms. Chapter 12, verse 3. The Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaketh proud things. And I have to be very careful about it. God, the Bible, God is not against any other sin. God is compassionate to all the sins. Murderer, God doesn't say I'm against murderers. God doesn't say I'm against adulterers. God doesn't say I'm against robbers. He is against murder. He is against robbery. He is against adultery. Not the people who commit that. He loves them. He makes His grace abound toward them. Where there is sin, He makes His grace abound toward them so that they can come out of that sin. But only one sin God abhors, or God is against. Not only that sin, that sinner, man with pride. Man with pride. Only to the man with pride, the proudish man, proud man, God is against. God is against. The very fall of Satan is not because he committed adultery, not because he murdered. After his fall, he murdered. He's a murderer. He's a liar. But the cause for his fall is not lie. The cause for his fall is not murder. The cause for his fall is pride. God resisteth the pride man, the proud people. So the Lord shall cut off all flattering lips and the tongue that speaketh proud things. It doesn't mean as a part of education you speak something about yourself. Now, we have to be very careful about it. So something about yourself, something about your talent, a self-introduction is not just kissing your own palm. A self-introduction, it's not just kissing your own palm. Suppose you are facing an interview. You have to show the merit that is in you. That's not pride. We have to understand that. That is not pride. So to understand what is pride, I show you the next verse, chapter 12, verse 4. Who have said, with our tongue will we prevail? Their pride comes. With our tongue will we prevail. Our lips are worn. Who is Lord over us? Who is Lord over us? That is the pride God is against us. Speaking very high. Oh, I'll do this, I'll do that, I can do it. To believe that I can do it, even to say that I can do it, absolutely that's not wrong. But is it born out of the pride in you, or it is born out of the confidence that you have in the Lord, or it is born out of the blessing the Lord has given you? I always love this phrase like this. I can do all things through Christ that strengtheneth me. I can do all things, but through Christ that strengtheneth me. And Jesus said, you can't do anything without me. Ennai balapaduthugira Kristuvinale ellavathaiyum seiya mudiyum. Yesu sonna ennale andi ungalala onnume seiya mudiyum. என்னாலே அன்றி உங்களால் ஒன்றுமே செய்ய முடியாது. ஆனால் என்னை பலப்படுத்துகிற கிறிஸ்துவினாலே எல்லாவற்றையும் செய்ய என்னால் முடியும். அப்போ என்னாலே முடியும் என்று சொல்லுவது, that itself is not pride. So there is a great difference between the confidence I got. That's not self-confidence. I got that confidence because of the grace that is bestowed upon me. The grace the Lord has given me. I can run through a army. I can leap over a wall, David says. David could do it. He can leap over a wall. He can run through an army. He can do it. Because God is with him. He can walk through the valley of the shadow of death, he fears no evil because God was with him. So confidence is different. Pride is different. In your confidence, God is there. God is there. His mercies are there. His grace is upon you. Because God is with you, you have got that confidence. In pride, God is absent. In pride, God is absent. You are praising God for the blessing God has given you. It's not wrong. My dear brother, my dear sister. The other day, one gentleman was talking with me, he said, about his relatives. Always they say they don't have anything, they don't have anything, they don't have anything, till this day they don't have anything. They are unable to be happy with what the Lord has given them. My dear brother, my dear sister, I lack no good thing. I don't have people to pity on me, but I got people to envy at me. From day in memory, even while I was working, I always say, we are single yearning. The family is with double yearning. We were with single yearning. But people were envious at us. Nobody pitied us. Till this day. My dear brother, my dear sister, that's not pride. So you have to be very careful about it. Appreciation is not flattery. Similarly, a humor is not mischief. Hear this. Confidence is not pride. Confidence is not pride. But if there is pride in us, we have to be very careful about it. And in our words, we have to be very careful that we don't mix pride in it. Some people, they talk about themselves, their pride, their family, their riches, but their children, everything, they talk very high. We have to be very careful about it. God is against people with pride. And number five, this is very common with many people, but that's a sin. Psalm 15 verse 3. He that backbiteth not with his tongue, he will go to Zion. Who will be in Zion? He that backbiteth not with his tongue. Speaking at the back. If anybody has got that habit, I got a number of references, I don't want to get into that. I don't want to give you all those references, bombard with those references. Today it's a very simple message, but a practical one, that you could be blessed. Do I have the habit of speaking at the back of somebody? When I see that person, oh brother, there's nobody like your sister, it's nobody like you, etc., etc., etc. As soon as that person leaves that place, at his back, you're Sariyana Bor, I don't like him. It is an evil, it's a sin. It's a sin with your tongue. You've got a double standard. You're not sincere. Very cheap. You are covered. You cannot speak that at the face. You speak at the back. You are a coward. Think for a minute. Guile is found in this. Those who are in Mount Zion, in Revelation 14. The characteristics of those are found in Mount Zion. Seven characteristics, that 144,000. One is, No guile was found in their mouth. No guile was found in their mouth. No guile was found. Jesus said, yes is yes, no is no. Anything more than that is of the devil. Yes is yes, no is no. Ullathe ullathennu illathe illathennu sol. Adarku minjinathu theemayinal alla. In the original it says, thiyavanal undayirukku. It is of the devil. Yes is yes, no is no. Anything more than that, it is of the devil. So we have to be very careful about it, not to backbite. Just imagine a scene. Husband, a wife, a small child, maybe some 5 or 6 year child, old child. The mother is talking about somebody, some auntie. Yo, that auntie, I don't like to see her. That auntie is a blade, mukka blade. I don't like to talk to her. Yo, it's horrible. She is telling her husband. Doorbell rings. She goes, opens the door and finds that auntie standing there. Oh, auntie, auntie, come, come, come. We are just talking about you only, auntie. Lapa, you are not busy. Yo, auntie, how happy to meet you, auntie. We always love you, auntie. God is very gracious. Hell is made only for you, sister. Otherwise, where to leave these people? They can't go to heaven. So they need a place to go. So God has created hell for them. How gracious He is. Otherwise, for all these type of actors, actresses, where can we send them? The child will think, see, so many people get Oscar prize. Oscar prize must be given to my mummy. What a good actress she is. Yaar yaarukku Oscar prize kudukana enga amma maari nadikka mudiyum enna alaga. The child will learn from you. That is backbiting, speaking at the back. Maybe it's very common with many people. Even the book of Proverbs, there is a very powerful verse. You buy something, to the buyer you say, idella nalladhu illa enga idhukku poi ulla vela kodupaangala idhu avule nalla illanga idhukkellam 10 rupaya kodukku idhu onnum illanga kuppa maari irukkutunga charger ponna podura 5 rupaya theriya sharing the 7 rupaya நல்லதல்ல நல்லதல்ல என்பான். போன பின்பு ஆஃப்டர் தட் மர்ச்சன்ட் இஸ் கான் ஹீல் போஸ்ட் வித் திஸ் வைப் பார்த்தியா, இதெல்லாம் 20 ரூபாய்க்கு கூட கிடையாது, பேசி வாங்கிட்டேன் 7 ரூபாய்க்கு. உனக்கு தான்ப்பா நரகம் ரெடியாக இருக்குது. யூ டோல் தட் மேன் நல்லதல்ல நல்லதல்ல, போன பின்பு மெச்சிக்கொள்வான். போன பின்பு மெச்சிக்கொள்வான். பின்னாலே இந்த மாதிரி கிடைக்குமா, நான் சாமர்த்தியமாக வாங்கிட்டேன். திஸ் சாமர்த்தியம் இஸ் நாட் அக்செப்டபிள் இன் ஹெவன். திஸ் சாமர்த்தியம் இஸ் நாட் அக்செப்டபிள் இன் அ ஜென்டில்மேன்லினஸ். இஃப் இட் இஸ் குட் யூ டெல்லிங் இட் இஸ் குட், இஃப் இட் இஸ் பேட் யூ டெல்லிங் இட் இஸ் பேட். இஃப் இட் இஸ் வர்த் 20 ரூபீஸ் கேன் யூ பி ஆனஸ்ட்? ஹீ சேஸ் 10 ரூபாங்க. இதென்ன 10 ரூபாயா? 20 ரூபாப்பா அந்த பிடிப்பா, 20 ரூபா பேர் இந்த 20 ரூபா வச்சுக்கப்பா அப்படி சொல்கிறோம்மா. அவன்கிட்ட 2 ரூபாய்க்கு சண்டை போட்டு அந்த 2 ரூபா குறைச்சி வாங்கிட்டு அவன் ஏதோ கிடைக்கிற லாபத்தில் சரி போகுது விற்றா சரின்னு விற்றுட்டு போயிட்டான். அவன்கிட்ட அந்த 2 ரூபா பார்கெயின் பண்ணிவிட்டு அதில் ஒரு பெருமைங்க அவன் போன பிறகு. See, this is not, number one, this is not a gentlemanliness. I mean, I don't want you to be hurt. I love you. I love you. And I'm talking this with our brother Selvam and others. I hear those who go with me to different places, they know how I talk with others. Keeping them, I am preaching. Take a straight life. That's a great joy in it. Speak to them, maybe lovingly. You need not use hard words. But same time, it's a backbiting, use loving words. Lovingly explain to them. If there is a hurt, you tell them affectionately. You need not say madu, but you can say pasu. But we may mean one and the same. In English we call that euphemism. So in an euphemistic way, in a gentle way, you can tell them what is that you want to communicate. I remember once when I was preaching this, somebody asked me like this. சரி ஒரு வீட்டுக்கு போகிறோம், காஃபி கொடுக்குறாங்க. காஃபி கழனி தண்ணி மாதிரி இருக்குது. தட் டைம் தே ஆஸ்க் ஹவ் இஸ் காஃபி பாஸ்டர், வாட் டு சே. டூ திங்ஸ், வென் யூ சே இட் இஸ் குட், டோன்ட் கோ அவுட் அண்ட் சே இட் இஸ் பேட். இஃப் யூ சே இட் இஸ் குட், யூ ஸ்டே ஆன் தட். பட் வென் யூ திங்க் இட் இஸ் நாட் குட், டோன்ட் சே இட் இஸ் பேட். ஐம் சாரி, வென் யூ think that it is not good, don't say, oh, it's very nice. இப்படி நான் குடித்ததே இல்லை. ஆஹா, அப்படி குடித்ததே இல்லைங்கிறது உண்மைதான். But what's that you want to communicate? If you say it is good, you stand on it. If you say it is bad, you stand on it. எப்படிங்க சொல்கிறது? மூஞ்சில் அடிச்சால சொல்ல முடியுமா? You must have a way to say that. எங்கள் வீட்டிலலாம் காஃபிக்கு சீனி போடுவாங்க, உங்கள் வீட்டில் உப்பு போட்டிருக்கீங்க போல. அதுவும் ஒரு வித்தியாசமான டேஸ்ட் தான். எனக்கு இந்த டேஸ்ட் ஒத்து வரல. இதான் முதல் முறை நான் உப்பு போட்டு காஃபி குடிக்கிறேன். மை டியர் பிரதர், மை டியர் சிஸ்டர், ப்ராபப்ளி யூ மே ஹவ் அ வே டு சே தட், பட் சர்ட்லி நாட் பேக் பைட். ஸோ இன் எவ்ரி பாயிண்ட் வாட் ஐ எம் ஷேரிங் வித் யூ டுடே, யூ மஸ்ட் ஹவ் அ பேலன்ஸ்ட் அப்ரோச். See, appreciation is not wrong, flattering is wrong. I don't say you have to blame everybody, but I tell you, don't backbite. Don't backbite. What you speak up to the face, you speak that same thing with others. If I tell somebody, brother, you are very good, tell others also that brother is good. Tell others also that brother is good. If you tell somebody, I don't like this in you, tell others also, I don't like this in him. I like him very much, but I don't like this in him. Be frank. With all humility, to your edification, I tell you, it is possible. It is possible. My dear brother, my dear sister, don't speak bad about others at their back. It doesn't mean that you hurt them in front of them. No, that's not what I mean. We have to be very careful about it. And number six, this is a very common thing, and you might have heard a number of verses. I don't want to spend much time about it. Psalm 50 verse 19. Thou givest thy mouth to evil. Thou givest thy mouth to evil. What is that? And thy tongue frameth deceit. Deceit, speaking falsehood. In Tamil, the translation is beautiful. Unnavu sarpanayai panaikkirathu, kadavududhu. In ordinary college rags, if I say, kadha thirikkidhu. Avade thirikkidhu kadha. Kannu mooku vachi. சர்ப்பனையை பிணைக்கிறது. Psalm 52 verse 4. Thou lovest all devouring words, ஓ thou deceitful tongue. அப்படியே மற்றவங்களை ஏமாத்துற மாதிரி ஜோடிச்சு, உண்மைக்கு மாறாக கயர் திரிச்சு, கதை விட்டு, அப்படியே உண்மை மாதிரி. It's a deceit. The Lord abhors it. We should also abhor it. Psalm 120 verse 2. Deliver my soul, O Lord, from lying lips and from a deceitful tongue. from lying lips and deceitful tongue. Psalm 109 verse 2. For the mouth of the wicked and the mouth of the deceitful are opened against me. They have spoken against me with a lying tongue, deceitful tongue, lying tongue. I just give one more verse. Psalm 120 verse 3. What shall be given unto thee, or what shall be done unto thee, thou false tongue, deceitful tongue, lying tongue, false tongue, all mean one and the same. Don't speak lies, even for a joke. Even for a joke, don't speak lie. Be mature. Avoid speaking lies. God doesn't love it. All liars will go to hell. Can we say that I lied only for a joke and I come to heaven? The Bible says all liars will go to hell. So we have to be very careful about lies. I don't want to speak much about it. All liars will go to hell. So lying tongue, deceitful tongue, கதை திரிக்கிறது, கதை விடுறது, உண்மைக்கு மாறாக பேசுறது. We have to be very careful about it. Evangelist and Jeevanandam used to say, pacha poyi, vella poyi, karupu poyi. There's nothing like that. Summa sonne, samalikkiradhukaga sonne. About one person, his wife said, Pastor, avar vaaya therandhale poyi thaan pesuvar. What a testimony it is. I just say one incident, I'm fighting against time. One day, Pastor Sundaramaya's son, he asked for some money, some excursion or something, money. Pastor Sundaram said, Nalaikitar. So the boy said, அப்ப சும்மா சொல்றீங்க அப்பா சும்மா சொல்றீங்க நாளைக்கு தரேன் த பாய்ஸ் அப்ப சும்மா சொல்றீங்க ஹி இமீடியட்லி டுக் ஹிஸ் சன் பை ஹேண்ட் வென்ட் இன் டு த ரூம் புட் த ப்ரேயர் மேட் நெல்ட் பிஃபோர் ஹிஸ் சன் நெல்ட் பிஃபோர் ஹிஸ் சன் அண்ட் ஆஸ்ட் தம்பி என்னைக்காவது அப்பா வந்துட்டு சும்மா சொல்லியிருக்கேன் என்னைக்காவது அப்பா உன்ற சும்மா சொல்லியிருக்கேன் மை டியர் பிரதர் தட் பாய் வாஸ் வீப் இல்லைப்பா நான் தெரியாமல் சொல்லிட்டேன்ப்பா எப்படி உன் வாயில் என்னை பற்றி அப்படி ஒரு வார்த்தை சொன்னேன் அப்பா சொன்னால் செய்வார் சொல் தவறாதவனாக இருந்தால் பூர்ண புருஷன் ஈவன் தேட் வேர்ட் தட் செயின்ட் வாஸ் அன்ஏபிள் டு பேர் ஃப்ரம் ஹிஸ் சன் ஹியர் தட் டைப் ஆஃப் டெஸ்டிமனி ப்ரேஸ் காட் தட் ஹி வாஸ் மை பாஸ்ட் Praise God that he was my past. They were very careful about their words. They were able to command respect from their children. Appa poi solla maattare. Appa summa solla maattare. Appa tharen sonna tharvare. They were able to command such a high respect. So words are very powerful tool. We communicate. It's a vehicle. Words are vehicle of our thoughts. Words reveal our personality. Words are very powerful. How do we handle these words? When I was working, the principal said, when you speak a word, you must know all the dimensions of that word. Mr. K. A. Thomas, a renowned educator this India has ever seen. I'm really privileged. I'm very happy that I had wonderful parents. I'm very happy that my pastor was wonderful. And my principal, a very unique person, the Lord blessed me with everything good, good wife, good children, good relatives, everything is good. Because my God is good. So I learned this from him. You must know the dimension of your words. What are the dimensions? The length, breadth and the width, or the depth. The length, breadth, the depth or the height. All three dimensions. What do you mean? how long these words will go. You speak out a word, but can you know how long it will go? Number two, how broad it will spread. Number three, how deep or how high it will go. How deep or how high it will go. You must know all the dimensions of what you speak. Words got all dimensions. It will go lengthwise, spread widthwise, height or depth. My dear brother, my dear sister, x-axis, y-axis, z-axis. Number seven. So we have to be very careful about the words we speak. No lying words. Number seven. Very, very important. With this I conclude. My soul is among lions, and I lie even among them that are set on fire. Even the sons of men, whose teeth are spears and arrows, and their tongue a sharp sword. The tongue of a wife, the tongue of a husband, the tongue of a mother-in-law, daughter-in-law, father-in-law, son-in-law, friend, or somebody, a boss, a sharp sword. Earlier, mischief is like a sharp razor, but this is a sword. Hurting words. It'll break others. It is not, instead of making, it will mar them. Instead of building, it will break them. You may correct your children. You may have to express your disapproval. The very purpose is to correct that person. The purpose is not to corrupt that person. The purpose is to correct that person. The purpose is not to mar him, the purpose is to make him. The purpose is not to break him, the purpose is to build him. The words of some people are very sharp sword, hurting words. In Psalm 64 verses 3 and 4, who wet their tongue like a sword and bend their bows to shoot their arrows, even bitter words. Just they vomit bitter words. That will cause bitterness. I send bitter arrows on somebody, and that bitterness will come upon him. He will become bitter. It is contagious. It is contagious. By hurting others, we can never be happy. Just imagine a husband and wife relationship. Just imagine for a minute, husband and wife relationship. By hurting my wife, can I be happy? I may be sadist. I may get a type of an enjoyment, entertainment by seeing others weeping. That's a sadist. Many of us have got a trace of sadist in us. See, some people, they don't know how to play with the child. The child has got a toy or something. They'll just pluck the toy from the child. The child will be weeping. They'll hide it for some time. They make the child weep, run around. It's a joy for them. What is the difference between that person and throwing a slave into a lion's circus, watching and enjoying the lion tearing that person to death? What is the difference? This father or mother or uncle, auntie or grandpa, or whosoever it may be, he gets a joy by making the child cry. After a few minutes, okay, don't cry. Give that. See, he finds joy in making the child cry. That is sadist. One person may get a joy by making a child cry. Another person may get a joy by giving a toy to the child, making the child smile. Who is gentle? One father plucks the toy from the child, makes the child cry, and it's a play. For another father gives a toy to the child, makes the child happy and play. Both just for play. But who is gentle, who is sadist? Who is gentle, who is sadist? Why should we take a sadistic way? How can I be happy because I hurt somebody? Even there's a small quarrel, I hurt my wife. She said, I'll also be sad. It's a very simple logic. It's a very simple logic. If you can make her happy, you can be happy. Everybody can be happy. Why do we miss this logic? If I can make others happy, I'll be happy. If I make others sad, I got two options. If I'm a sadist, I'd be happy over. I would be it's an entertainment for me to see others are sad. Then I am a sadist. Otherwise, when I make others unhappy, I'll also be unhappy. If I want to be happy, the simple formula, I make others happy, I can also be happy. It's very simple. Today, take a decision. I speak to me also. I don't say I am perfect. But I understand this. I understand this. Why do you use hurting words? When I was preparing this, I remember this Thirukkural. It's a very simple one. இனிய உளவாக என்னாது கூறல் இனிய உளவாக என்னாது கூறல் கனி இருப்ப காய் கவர்ந்தட் கனி இருப்ப காய் கவர்ந்தட் Even I tell you, even when you are correcting your child, correct it in a low pitch, not in a high pitch. Not in a high pitch. Don't do it. No, don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it! It's funny. Funny. My dear brother, my dear sister, it's a very simple thing. When I was praying yesterday, just with this I conclude. I was asking Lord, what this message you have given me. The Lord reminded me a passage in the Bible. I just read out that passage to you and I'm going to pray. Isaiah chapter 6. I'm going to read first 9 verses. I'm going to read. Isaiah chapter 6 verse 9 verses. In the year that King Uzziah died, I saw also the Lord sitting upon a throne, high and lifted up, and his train filled the temple. He had a vision of the Lord. Above it stood the seraphims. Each one had 6 wings. With twine he covered his face, and with twine he covered his feet, and with twine he did fly. And one cried unto another and said, Holy, holy, holy is the Lord of hosts. The whole earth is full of his glory. And the posts of the door moved at the voice of him that cried, and the house was filled with smoke. So he had an appearance of the glory of the Lord. In the temple he beheld the very presence of God and the seraphims. Verse 5. Then said I, then the prophet said, Woe is me, for I am undone, because I am a man of unclean lips, and I dwell in the midst of the people of unclean lips. Just think for a minute. My mouth, my tongues, my lip, is it clean before God? Here a saint, a great prophet, Isaiah, he said, Lord, I am a man with unclean lips. He cried, and I dwell in the midst of people of unclean lips, maybe unclean tongue. It's not murder, it's not adultery, it's not fornication. It's a deceit. Flattering others for some favor. talking blah 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 blah, vain words which others could not be edified, using hurting words, mischief, unclean things. Lord, I am dwelling with the people, midst of a people of unclean lips, but my eyes have seen the King, the Lord of hosts, a holy God. I'm worshipping a holy God. As my eyes have seen that holy God. I heard about some biblical truth. How a gentleman should be. How can I be happy? How can I make others happy? I heard that, O Lord. Now this revelation has come to me. When he prayed, then flew one of the seraphims unto me, having a live coal in his hand, which he had taken with the tongs. He can take the live coal with his hands, the seraphim. Seraphim means fire. Seraphim means fire. Seraphim is unable to take that live coal with his hand. He has taken it with tongs. From where that fire comes, it is the altar. From the altar he takes that fire and he laid it upon my mouth and said, he touched my mouth, the lips, the fire the seraphim is unable to touch with his fingers, with that live coal he touched my lips and he said, thine iniquity is taken away. What all he has spoken with the unclean lips, unclean tongue, with your mouth. The Lord said, your iniquity is taken away and thy sin is purged. Sin in your tongue is purged. Verse 8. Purasawalkam. It's very important. And I heard the voice of the Lord saying, whom shall I send? And who will go for us? Then said I, when my tongue is touched, when my mouth is touched, and that anointing touched me, then said I, here am I. Whom shall I send? Here am I. Send me. And he said, go. When the Lord touches your mouth, your lips, your tongue, when your sin is purged away, you will be, the name of Jesus, I tell you, the mouth of the Lord. He will send you to people for your cause. Shall we just stand to your feet? Let the anointing fall on you. Let the Holy Spirit touch your mouth, your lips, your life, your heart, every part. The Lord will tell you, go. For his cause, you would be able to go. Just very solemnly, we sing that chorus, anointing, fall on me.
Anointing.
With your hands lifted up,
fall on
look into the Lord.
Anointing.
Urisha nama rabadi nama.
Fall on me.
Jesus,
follow me, anointing, fall on me. Touch my hands, my mouth and my heart. Fill my life, Lord, every thought. Let the
Hallelujah. Rabba, Rabba. Ask the Lord, touch me, O Lord. Touch my mouth, O Lord. Let the fire from the altar touch my mouth, O Lord. Hallelujah. 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 Commit your life into the hands of the Lord. The Lord will use you mightily. Hallelujah. 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 Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Uri Damara Bada Bala Bashanama. When your mouth is made clean, when your mouth is made clean, it is a prophecy unto you, it's a prophecy unto you. I will lay my words on you in your mouth, and you will speak my word. The Lord tells you, sister. The Lord tells you, brother. I will lay my words in your mouth. En vaarthegalai un vaayile vaippe. Nee en vaarthegalai pesuvai. Hallelujah. Bahana maraba. En vaarthegalai un vaayile vaippe. Nee avegalai pesuvai. Hallelujah. Nama. The Lord will lay his words in your mouth. The Lord will lay his words in your mouth. Urabana maraba. He will speak those words. Hallelujah. The words that could edify others. The words that could comfort others, the words that could caution others, the words that could prepare others to meet the Lord. Hallelujah. Whatever your profession may be, or you may be a school student, you may be a college student, you may be working, you may be in the full-time ministry, you may be a housewife, the Lord will keep his words in your mouth, and he will speak those words. Words which could build others, words which could destroy their sin in their life, words which could edify others, words which could prepare others to meet the Lord. The Lord will keep his words in your mouth. You can speak to your children. Your children will be blessed. When you speak to your children will be anointed. When you speak to your children, they will hear the words of the Lord from your mouth. Hallelujah, Bana Maraba. Dear mother, dear father, dear brother, dear sister, your children should not hear lies from your mouth. Your children should not hear mischief from your mouth. Your children should not hear deceits from your mouth. Your children should hear words of heaven from them, your mouth. There must be honey. There must be milk in your mouth. Your words should edify your children. Your words should build up your children. Your friends, your colleagues, your neighbors, your relatives, your superiors, those who are working for you, they should hear the words of God from your mouth. They should hear the words anointed from your mouth. Words of encouraging words, words which can build, words which can speak the truth, words of honesty. What is it they are going to hear from you? From my mother, I'll hear only words of honesty. From my mother, I'll hear only words of truth. My mother is not saying something to flattery. My mother will not speak deceits. My mom will never say a lie. Let your child be blessed through you, brother, sister. Ori namara basha namara. What does your wife say? வீட்டுக்கார் வாயை திறந்தாலே போய் சொல்லுவார். நோ, லெட் காட் எரேஸ் த டெஸ்டிமனி டுடே. லெட் த ஃபயர் ஃப்ரம் த ஆல்டர் பர்ன் அவே த டெஸ்டிமனி. லெட் யுவர் சின் பி பர்ச்ட். ஊரீஷ நமாரவா. யுவர் இனிக்விட்டி டேக்கன் அவே. ஃப்ரம் டுடே லெட் தேர் பி எ நியூ டெஸ்டிமனி. My mom will never say a lie. Let that testimony come. My husband will never speak hurting words. The words of my husband may be for correction, to build me up, not to break me up. Let the wife say that. Let the husband say that. Your family will be a blessed family. What my husband says is only to build me up, not to break me. Brother, commit your life for that testimony. Sister, commit your life for that testimony. A wise woman builds that family, not breaks the family. Your words are very powerful. Your word can make, your words can mar. It has got a creative power. In the name of Jesus, I tell you this and conclude. Death and life, happiness and sorrow, good and bad, is in the power of your tongue. Is in the power of your tongue. The Spirit of the Lord has spoken to us. Shall we pray?